All right, Acts chapter 17, verse 1 through 15. Now, when it comes to proclaiming the gospel of Jesus, you are guaranteed to have at least two different responses, at least two, a favorable one and a not so favorable one, right? But we share one message, the good news about Jesus. But we can never predict how people are going to respond to the news about Jesus, the good news about Jesus. In Acts chapter 17, Paul shared about Jesus in three different cities, Thessalonica, Berea, and Athens. In our study, we're going to see the first 15 verses, and we're going to see Paul in the city of Thessalonica and Berea. Lord willing, next week we'll complete the rest of 17, where Paul is in Athens. Message title is This Jesus. Same message, different responses. And that has always been the heart with Paul's ministry, is to proclaim Jesus. But how people respond, you know, we just need to trust the power of God's word and the Holy Spirit. Amen? So with that, let's look at the first four verses. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews, and Paul went in, as was his custom. And on three Sabbath days, he reasoned, underline that word, reasoned. On three Sabbath days, he reasoned with them from the scriptures, explaining and proving that it was necessary for the Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead, saying, "This Jesus whom I proclaim to you is the Christ." And some of them were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a great many of the devout Greeks and not a few of the leading women. So here's Paul and his missionary team that included Silas and Timothy. And they headed southwest from Philippi to Thessalonica. And Thessalonica is a major city. It's a major port city. And it's in Macedonia. And it's been, I think they have approximately about 200,000 people at that time. And I would imagine that some of us, or maybe many of us, would have packed it in and called it a day if we weren't in Paul's shoes after the incident that happened in Lystra, where he was stoned and left for dead. And what did he do when that happened? He got up and went back to Jerusalem or to Antioch? No, he went back to the same city, to the same people that stoned him. And then he left, went to Derbe, and all. That was from his first missionary journey. Now this is his second missionary journey. Now that one, after what he went through, maybe we, if we were in his shoes, we may have probably questioned our calling after enduring false accusations, attacks from an angry mob, stripped and beaten by rods, sent to prison, and, by the way, survived an earthquake. Would have given up right there now? Nope. Not Paul and his team. They kept marching on and preaching on to the next town, to the next city. They would not allow their suffering to stop them from sharing Jesus. In fact, for these men, it's all about pressing on. Now, unlike the city of Philippi, where they did not find a synagogue, Thessalonica had a synagogue. And as you guys already know, that Paul's missions policy is to always find a synagogue. And when he did, he went and shared about Jesus to the Jews there. However, in many of these synagogues weren't just only Jews, but many Gentiles were in attendance as well. Some of them we may even call God-fearers. So while in the city of Thessalonica, Paul shared about Jesus for three Sabbaths, that is 3 weeks, in a row. And in each time he went, he reasoned. All right? He reasoned with the people in the synagogue, especially with the Jews, about Jesus, but using scripture. And that word reasoned in the Greek is dialogomai. And we have a familiar English word from there. It's dialogue or dialogue. That's where we get that word dialogue from, which means to either argue or to discuss with reasonable discourse or conversation. So the scripture that is speaking here is in reference to the Old Testament scripture, where Paul made an argument. He made a strong case about Jesus because the Old Testament contains references that points directly to who? To who? Jesus. All right, I want to make sure that the hot dogs and the hot links didn't affect you or anything tonight. So here's the question for you guys that are doing your daily reading of God's Word. All right, these past 6 months, we're going on 7 months here in a couple of days. How many of you, when you read your Bible daily, look for Jesus, especially in the Old Testament? Have you been doing that for the past 6 months? All right, good. Two people. No, I'm sure all of you are just shy. I know all of you are just shy. But that is one way to read through the throughout the year daily. It's like, man, where's Jesus in that? I think it's like the coolest thing. It's cool how you can see whether you want to call it a shadow, a type, or direct reference to Jesus. And which brings up this one point. I think it is silly of Christians, not all, but certain Christians today play down the Old Testament. That is, I'm sorry, but that is the dumbest thing I've ever heard. They make a weak argument that it's not relevant for today when in fact teaching Jesus from the Old Testament is just as important as teaching Jesus from the New Testament. Because if you really think about it, from Genesis all the way through Revelation, the Bible is all about pointing to who? Man, you guys are awesome tonight. You're going 2 for 2. And part of Paul's teachings about Jesus included why he had to suffer on our behalf, but also that he was raised from the dead. Such Old Testament example would begin in the Old Testament, Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Where that is like the first, you know, gospel that was written from the very beginning. Deuteronomy 18, about the coming prophet Moses spoke about. Psalm 22, Isaiah 53. And there's many, many more other scripture references from the Old Testament that points to Jesus' suffering and him also raising from the dead. In fact, it's about Jesus. He suffered. He died for our sins by way of being crucified on the cross. However, to show that he had victory over sin and death and that he is the Savior of the world, he rose from the dead. How lame is he if he did all that and then did not raise from the dead? Just read 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It even says that if he did not raise from the dead, we are the most to be pitied. But Jesus' resurrection was an historical event in human history, just like his incarnation, just like his crucifixion, his burial, his resurrection, and his ascension. And many areas in the Old Testament attest to that truth. So Paul made enough of a strong case about Jesus that some were persuaded by Paul's preaching. And that word persuaded, as used here in the original language, means to convince. It means to believe, to trust, even to obey. It's just putting everything what Paul had taught about Jesus. Some were persuaded or believed Paul's teaching from the Old Testament scripture concerning Jesus, that some of the Jews that were there believed the message that Paul shared. And then a large number of God-fearing Greek men and quite a few of the prominent influential leading women in Thessalonian society had ultimately placed their trust in Jesus. This is great because through the gospel of Jesus, communities and cities were slowly turning to Jesus. I'm not saying the entire population turned to Christ, but enough that it would change society for the better. There was a time when our society was influenced by what? The Word of God, that it permeated our society and our culture. It didn't mean that everyone was a Christian, but I think it's just interesting that there was a period in our nation's history where our society was just different. Think about that. And then the moment that prayer was removed from schools, the Word of God was removed from schools. And at one point, statesmen, there are now politicians, but statesmen had put Christ first. And how many politicians we could say today that put Christ first? God is no longer in the equation. It's all about votes and power and such. But the point I want to make is like when our Judeo principles and influence has been removed from our society, it's no wonder today, at least here in the United States, that we're becoming more and more what they call for the past 20 years a postmodern Christian nation, but we're becoming even more godless nation. I don't even have to tell you what's going on around this world. Just look at the news or read the news and see what is going on out there. But you know what? Having said that, let's not give up. Let's pray. Let's continue to pray, not only for our nations, but all the nations around the world. We need to pray for a major spiritual awakening that will sweep across our nation and the world, where people will feel that burden and that need for Jesus. Now everyone was happy about Paul's preaching and the outcome of his preaching. Look at verse 5 through 9. But the Jews were jealous, and taking some wicked men of the rabble, they formed a mob, set the city in an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason, seeking to bring them out to the crowd. And where they could not find him, they dragged Jason and some of the brothers before the city authorities, shouting, "These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also." And Jason has received them, and they are all acting against the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus. And the people in the city authorities were disturbed when they heard these things. And when they had taken money as security from Jason and the rest, they let them go. So the Jews refers to the religious leaders of the synagogue, and they responded to the outcome of Paul's teaching with what? Jealousy. Notice that they didn't want to reason or even to refute Paul's teaching, but what they wanted to do instead is to incite a mob against Paul. The rabble, that word the rabble, is a marketplace. Think of it like today, like an outdoor mall. Everyone is there. Everyone is hanging out. It's a public, visible place. And where these bitter, jealous Jews found these really bad dudes, okay, loitering around the rabble or the marketplace, and they used them to start this mob that just erupted the city. Kind of similar to what some of these folks happened over in Philippi. Verse 7 showed that a man named Jason had taken Paul and his team into his house, establishing their association with each other. And since they could not find Paul and Silas and Timothy, they said, well, let's get the other Christians. If we can't find them, we'll get the other ones. So they go and hit Jason's house, and they drag them out, Jason and his the brothers in Christ, and they brought them before the city authorities. I mean, this is a classic case of guilt by association, right? Because they could not find Paul and Silas, they persecuted these Christians because of their association with them. And I am sure that Jason and the other brothers would have never thought in their wildest of dreams that they would wake up one day and get pulled from their house, you know, and because they were associated with other brothers in Christ who proclaim the gospel of Jesus. I'm sure they woke up that morning not thinking that, wow, guys, today's a good day to be persecuted. I'm sure that is. I know I don't think that way. You know, I'm thinking, what's the next meal? You know, I'm not thinking about, you know, like a persecution. But the reality is that we are one in body in Christ. I guess we can also say that when one member suffers or is targeted, all members suffers and will be targeted as well. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 26 says, if one member suffers, all suffer what? Together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. It's kind of like what the Three Musketeers, all for one, one for all. Kind of thing. Is that, who's that? Alexander Dumas? Is right? Yeah. I got my literature resident scholar here, Leland. Thank you very much. Romans 12, 15. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. And so there is this strong connection among Christians throughout the world. It doesn't matter if we're here in California and our brothers and sisters in Christ are in Australia, Malaysia, China, Canada, in France. Wherever, whenever they suffer, we should be suffering with them. Remember when they took those Egyptian Christian, Coptic Christians, back I think in 2018 or 2016? How many of them? Well, like about 25 of them, right? And then they marched them down to the beach and then beheaded all of them. I don't know about you, but my heart felt. I felt that. And I think every Christian in around the world should have felt that as well. So there is that sense that, you know, when they're suffering, we should be able to weep with that. And when we rejoice, or when they rejoice, we should be able to rejoice with them. Because we're all part of the body of Christ. As one person put it, believers are in the world together. There is no such thing as a private, as private Christianity. What a statement. There is no such thing as private Christianity. Christ makes us one even when we wish otherwise. And now the accusers all shouted these famous words. These men who have turned the world upside down have come here also. I don't know. That to me, that sounds like a badge of honor. You know? Can you imagine that? Oh, there's a little Miss Jean. Yeah, she's the one that turned the world upside down. You know, wearing that. It's, how cool is that? Here's Camille. She turned the world upside down. Right? Matt turned the world upside down. That's like, it's like a badge of honor. See, what happened here is that they said that Christ followers like Paul and Silas with their message about Jesus, it says, have come here also, means their reputation, their message preceded them. When haters of the world said that followers of Jesus have turned the world upside down, they meant it. It was more than just a cliche or whatever they were thinking. They believed it. People like Saul and Silas and their message about Jesus made a profound impact in the world that time, and the world took notice. Some of you might be familiar with what it was called back in the 1800s, the Second Great Awakening. Under preachers like George Whitefield and Jonathan Edwards, where people would weep and they throw themselves at the church altar or at the pulpit, just repenting of their sins. And God's word has such a profound effect in society that societal changes and behavior took place where bars shut down. Houses of prostitutions were shut down while others went and joined to work for the abolition of slavery. What does that tell us? That's the power of God's word. That's the power of the gospel. Amen? Born-again people making a difference in society, influencing society with no hypocrisy, not because they're perfect, but the desire to manifest Jesus before a darkened world through their obedience of God's word and help from the Holy Spirit, and in the process, they change the world upside down. But if truth be told, the world is what's upside down, right? And the word of God has come to make it right side up. We can never, ever, folks, underestimate the power of God's word in conjunction with the power of the Holy Spirit. And may I add a third one? The power of prayer. All right? Amen? The power of prayer. Therefore, when the mob said they have turned the world upside down, that is to say that Paul and Silas were accused or charged for the offense of challenging the way of society or had created some societal unrest or turmoil. See, the message of Jesus went against the ways or the orders of the Roman law or the Greek cultural influence. Now, that doesn't mean, like, for us today that all the law, you know, everything that goes around, you know, like, well, I'm a Christian. I'm going to eat every red light, all right? We don't do stuff like that, all right? There are laws in place that we need to follow, okay? There are laws in place that we are to be productive citizens. See, but to be honest, Jesus and all that he has done for all of us, all of humanity, was and is and will continue to be the one who turns the world upside down. Because why did they claim that these men turned the world upside down? It's because the message of Jesus. So if it's about Jesus, he's the one who's actually turning the world around. But in truth, what the Bible really does is to cause everyone to see how far they have fallen from God's holy standard. How far and how distant we are from our loving Father, our Creator. Shows how sinful we are. The gospel shows their need of a Savior and shows the emptiness in their hearts and their need for God's grace and love. This is how faithful messengers of the Holy Spirit turn the world upside down, sharing about the gospel of Jesus. But notice the tactic. Those who can't refute truth, or at least have a civil discourse, they rely on what? Emotions. Paul reasoned with the Jews and everyone else who were at that synagogue. You know, he wanted to dialogue with them. He wanted to converse with them. In normal civil discourse, we should be able to either agree to disagree or at least consider what the other person is saying. Even today, as it was back then, with at least the religious Jews, that we have lost the ability to listen and consider what the other person is saying, even if their views differ from ours. Do you remember the old talk shows of the 70s and the 80s? You know, maybe some of you remember from the 60s. When they had, I wasn't born back then, I was born in the 90s. But, but you know, like if you watch old clips of, say, like David Frost, you know, or what's another guy out there that was, who? Dick Cavett. He was one, Dick Cavett. Yeah, that was your time. I remember that's your time. But you know, you watch these guys, you know, and there was a time when they had opposing views, but you were able to at least, okay, I know where this person stands. I know where this person stands. By the time they were done, they're shaking hands. I bet you they went to the nearest bar and just hung out for the rest of the night. No one knew any different, you know? Or what's that, Justice Scalia? Scalia, remember? He was good friends with Ruth Ginsburg. Different opposing ideology and stuff, and were best of friends for decades. But we're not seeing that today. You mentioned something, and then people just go out of left field. It's insane. You just can't have just a really good conversation, even if their views differ from yours or they differ from ours. But look, let's not forget that these, after they saw how many people responded, let's get back to the context of what's happening here. After what the people responded to Paul's teaching for 3 consecutive weeks using God's word and people coming to Jesus, these religious Jews were motivated by what? Jealousy. Okay? Jealousy caused them to look at Paul and his ministry as a threat to them, thus as rivals, because they saw how Paul effectively used God's word. I'm sure from Genesis all the way through Malachi, and then just sharing what the Lord had shared with him. You know, the truth of who he is. Concerning about this Jesus, that it resulted in both Jews and Gentiles coming to Christ. But here the religious Jews roused up the emotions of the people, causing an uproar in the city because of their jealousy. Again, does that sound familiar? If you can't win them in an argument, then let's get them in emotions. And we see that today. When someone doesn't agree with you, they appeal to their emotions, make false accusations, and use name-calling to shut the conversation. And in their emotion and blind jealousy, they accuse the Christians they dragged before the authorities of acting in such a way that was against the laws of Caesar and claiming Jesus as their king. Now, it is true as followers of Jesus that Jesus is our king and we belong to his kingdom. If you are a child of God, he is now your Lord. He is now your Savior. He is now your King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we now all belong to a different kingdom, his kingdom. He rules over us. That we are of the other kingdom, God's kingdom, we live as ambassadors in this world representing Jesus. And when Christians are representing Jesus, and more importantly, I mean, manifesting Jesus before this world, in my opinion, society can be better. And I'm not talking about people like that, those Westboro Baptist Church from Kansas. All they speak on is on hate. They're the same ones that go to these soldiers' funerals and they protest. And they do, it's such a desecration and such a disrespect for our fallen heroes. That is not Jesus. Jesus is not in that. That's not the love of God. There's nothing to do with God with that. The Crusades, some 1,000, 1,200 years ago, people, soldiers, religious leaders, and kings used Jesus and the Bible to wage war over Jerusalem. That has nothing to do with the historic Jesus. That has nothing to do with God's word. That has nothing to do with the church. Or as much as I like to see every abortion facilities eventually close down, bombing them has nothing to do with the historical Jesus of the Bible or the church. That's not representing God's love. I'd rather see these facilities or whatever you want to call them. I like to see it underway what happened at the Second Great Awakening, where people were convicted by God's word and the Holy Spirit that they closed down the bars themselves. They closed down all the prostitution rings and all that. It would be good to see people that are under the conviction of the Holy Spirit and God's word, that those things start closing down on their own. None of this, you know, in the name of Jesus, we're going to start blowing up places. That is not Jesus. That has nothing to do with the church. And there are many other things the world would like to bring up to paint a terrible picture of the church when the true body of Christ would never be called to do such a thing. There is a judgment that's coming, but God is going to take care of that. And he's going to do it his way. But until then, we live in an age of grace, and we need to be praying for these people that are just walking. They're walking their way to a cliff, to hell. And we want to be able to pray for them and pray that the Lord, just like, remember a couple of weeks ago, God had opened the heart of Lydia so that she can understand the gospel. We need to be praying for that too. People that we're in contact with, or these politicians, or whomever. You know, Lord, by your grace, just what you did for Lydia, can you please open their hearts so they can see Jesus and be transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit? Because I tell you what, we were all in that same boat. All right? We were all in that same boat. And it's by the grace of God that we are where we're at today. Amen? God's grace. Gotta love it. So yes, we are under, you know, another kingdom, a different king, Jesus. However, Paul, wherever he shared the gospel, Paul understood enough that when we live this side of heaven, we don't paint a picture of the church as we're a bunch of revolutionaries wanting to throw, like, say, Caesar and the Roman Empire, you know, because he saw that all these things are spiritual. As we live in this world, we live out Jesus to the best of our abilities with the help of the Holy Spirit as the people that are grounded in his word, okay? Remember, as Jesus said, that as we live as his followers in this world, that we give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and we give to God what belongs to God. That's how we live in this world. So we live in this world, but as members of God's kingdom. And we live in this world as productive citizens as long as the world is not asking us or put us in a position to compromise our faith in Jesus or to go against God's word. Now, having said all these things, to make the accusation that the church or that Paul and his team were there to spread some message against Caesar was absolutely not true. In fact, if you read all of Paul's letters, if you read John's letter, Peter's letters, they understood. They weren't there to overthrow the government. That was Judas Iscariot. He thought that that was what's going to happen. And when that didn't pan out, what did he do? He betrayed Jesus. And then out of guilt or whatever, he went and took his own life. But the others, they understood that the kingdom is not here on earth. The kingdom is with God. That's the key right there. But when you read their letter, it's not about overthrowing government. You know, it's not about that. People and the city authorities were so disturbed. And really what it was, that it was a misrepresentation of Paul's teaching based on scripture, that the authority was like, you know what? We don't have time for this. There is absolutely no charge here. Nothing we've got that's concrete that says that they said or did anything against Caesar or the empire. So basically, they got out on bail, all right? That's what happened. So Jason and the others, they got off on bail, and they were free. Verse 10 through 12, the brothers immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea, and when they arrived, they went into the Jewish synagogue. Now, these Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They received the word with all eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. Many of them, therefore, believed with not a few. That's a weird translation, not a few. That word means multitude, okay? With not a few Greek women of high standing as well as men. That Paul and Silas was released at night tells us that they were still wanted men, okay? And using the cover of night, they left with the help of other brothers in Christ, and they went over to the city of Berea. And upon arriving there, as Paul's custom, he finds a synagogue, and there he meets up with these Jews. But these particular Jews were different from the religious Jews from Thessalonica, for Luke described them as more noble. And the Greek word for noble is eugenes. If you were to see the English transliteration of that word, you will see the name Eugene, all right? Eugenes, Eugene, and it means noble. Or it also means open-mindedness. You know, that's the noble character about them. They were able to have an open mind. Eugenes, Eugene. And it was this characteristic of being open-minded that they received the word that Paul taught with all eagerness. And in their pursuit of God's word, they would examine the word of God and what Paul taught and what they did, you know, this examination, they were forever linked with the most positive and best compliment to anyone who were not just satisfied and just taking anyone's word on face value, but compared it to scriptures, and we call them what? Bereans. Today, even back then, to be called a Berean is a compliment. What it simply means is that you are a student of God's word. Unlike the religious Jews in Thessalonica, these Berean Jews received the word, meaning they accepted. That word, you know, it means that they welcomed it as being hospitable about it. In other words, with that word hospitable, how they welcomed, there was no hostility in their part. They were not hostile to what Paul was sharing. Received with eagerness, meaning there was a readiness, a willingness to receive God's word and Paul's teaching. They examined the scriptures daily. The word examine here in its original use means to study thoroughly, seek to learn the truth of by the process of careful study. Like as if an investigative reporter or an investigative person in a court. They did all this to see if what Paul and Silas taught actually matched up with the Old Testament scripture. Paul, that sounds really good. I like what you said about Jesus there, you know, about the tree, hanging on the tree, you know, stuff. I like that. But we're going to go back to the scripture and make sure what you said matches up. Oh, it matches up. That's the kind of people these Bereans were. This is why they were noble, because they took the time to hear what Paul had to say, but it's like, okay, I heard what you have to say, Paul and Silas, but now we want to take what you said, and we're going to now match it up, or at least compare it to Scripture, if what your words say matches up or aligns with the Word of God. It's not about indoctrination or being brainwashed, but to examine as an independent thinking student of God's Word. The Berean Jews examined the same message Paul and Silas shared in Thessalonica, and also in Philippi. Same message, different attitude. Same message, different response from the Thessalonican religious Jews there. But this is a great reminder for all of us that it is important that we are students of God's word, that we are Bereans in the 21st century here. And to always check anyone's teaching against God's word to see if it's true, if it aligns with the scripture, or if it contradicts and does not align with the scripture. But what was the result? It says that many of them therefore believed, with not a few Greek women of high standing as well as men. That wording, not a few, we've heard that earlier in the first four verses. It's a weirdly translated way of saying multitudes. So there was a lot of Gentiles that came to believe the teachings that Paul taught from the scripture. Just like in Thessalonica, there were Jews along with a multitude of prominent Gentile men and women of high standing in Berean society who were searching for the truth. And they heard the truth through Paul and pointing people to Jesus. And they came to believe and trust in Christ. Notice that Luke mentions a second time here in another Macedonian city of the Greek or Macedonian women who had great social and civic influence within their community. This is the second time Luke has mentioned this. He mentioned it in those in Thessalonica, and he mentions it again here in Berea. And of course, this is not a bad thing, or even, you know, that influential people can be used to live for Christ and make an impact on others within society. But I think it's interesting that Luke, you know, mentions it twice, that the women, a lot of women came to the faith in Christ, Gentile women, influential women, just like Lydia. She was an influential person in her in Philippi who was a successful businesswoman. And the early church Christian women from all walks of life were highly regarded. And I would like to think that it's the same here today. But what is important is that regardless of one's ethnic, cultural, or societal influence, both Jews and Gentiles came to faith in Jesus through Paul's faithful teachings about Jesus through what? Scripture. That is key. The success of the early church is how they handled the truth of God's word. Not about coming up some crazy ideology or something that is just weird. All these major apostles and disciples and evangelists and all, they relied heavily, and should we also, the word of God. So whether you are a preacher, teacher, or a friend, share God's word faithfully, but let the word, the power of the word of God do its work. Okay? Verse 13 to 15. But when the Jews from Thessalonica learned that the word of God was proclaimed by Paul at Berea also, they came there too, agitating and stirring up the crowds. Then the brothers immediately sent Paul off on his way to the sea, but Silas and Timothy remained there. Those who conducted Paul, conducted is another way of saying those who escorted Paul, brought him as far as Athens. And after receiving a command for Silas and Timothy to come to him as soon as possible, and then they departed. Now, it should not come as a surprise that when something good, when God is doing a great work, like what was happening in the city of Berea, that opposition rears its head, okay? The religious Jews from Thessalonica who rejected Jesus took the time to travel to Berea from Thessalonica after hearing what Paul was doing. And the success that was born from that disrupted the progress the Bereans were making through Paul's teachings. In many ways, this here is the start of this new church. I mean, if you have to travel, look, if you have to travel about maybe about 100-something miles from Thessalonica to Berea, I'm sorry, but it's no longer about you being jealous about what Paul is doing. At this point now, is like, now you're just attacking the gospel. Now you're just attacking the gospel messenger here, and which is Paul. At least that's how I look at this. Because of their hostility against Paul and his work, the fellowship in Berea quickly got a hold of Paul and sent to him, they escorted him, presumably to make sure that he is safe, and that they take him over to Athens, and they drop him off there, making sure that he arrived there fine, and then they all return back to Berea. And they were given instructions that when you get back to the city of Berea, please send Silas and Timothy to me. You know, so he wants to continue with the team. You know, it's Timothy and Silas here. So that's where we will end tonight's teaching here. So in closing, none of us can control how a person will respond to the gospel of Jesus. No one can predict how a person will respond or react to the truth of God's word. Some will believe, but others will reject. Some may be kind of nice to you. Some of them may hate you. But take courage. For those who reject the words you share about Jesus through the Bible, even you sharing your own personal testimony with God's word and what God has done in your life, look at it this way. You have at least planted a seed of God's word and grace in their hearts and minds. Okay? All we can do is pray and let the Spirit do His thing as we pray that the seed will eventually take root and sprout. Okay? I just want to say, if they reject you and your message, don't be discouraged, because who they're really rejecting is Christ. But just trust in the power of the gospel of Jesus. Yes, some will respond positively, others negatively. But the inner workings of the heart and mind is not our doing, but the Spirit. As the worship team comes up, we share Jesus. We press on as we trust the Word of God and the Spirit of God. Amen? And all of God's children said, amen, and to God be the glory. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for the power of your word and the power of the gospel that has the ability to turn the world upside down. Father God, we just pray that you would help us to be a people that are able to reason with others, that we are able to discuss, to dialogue. Give us opportunities to dialogue with the people in this world about what your son Jesus has done for us because of your love for us, Lord. Father, we ask that you would help us to be Bereans. Help us to be students of your word, Lord. Help us to be mentored and taught through your Holy Spirit with your word as our foundation. Father, we just praise you and we thank you, Lord, for the power of your word because it does change lives. Lord, we pray for those who are not saved yet. God, we pray that you would do to them what you did for Lydia. Open their hearts, open their minds, that they may receive, that they may understand, receive understanding of what Christ has done for us. We pray this in your Son's name, Jesus. Amen.